spending some time this morning listening to our keynote, and hopefully our presentation is going to be good. Right, so today we're going to talk about Lego Soccer Robot. My name is Fan. This is Brian.
I'm Jagnesh.
Right. So, first of all, we're going to talk about the motivation of our project. What is our motivation of our project? Why did our team choose this project? Well, simple answer, because all the members of our team are huge fans of soccer. And when we saw this picture, actually this was the final moment of the final match between Holland and Spain in the FIFA World Cup 2010, which was held in South Africa. We asked ourselves, what if the players in the pictures were actually robots instead? And if that's the case, we thought that it's going to be an interesting and fantastic experience to watch robots play soccer. And to talk more about the design of a robot, I want to invite Alex and Brian.
Alright, I was the designer of the defensive robot. The original design, this was basically what we based our results on and how we determined how we designed the robot. So we started out with the tripod, which was the standard design that we got from a little pamphlet that gave us instructions and everything. And it was really just mainly created to follow step-by-step instructions that we had to follow a maze, and we had to do a figure eight, you know, just the preliminary stuff to figure out how everything worked. And then motivation for the defensive robot was we're trying to do a foosball theme because we wanted it to be more of a goalkeeper and be able to defend the goal better. If we wanted it to be a little bit simpler so that we didn't have as many errors involved at all. So it basically just went back and forth side to side without moving front to back and was able to block the ball. The first defensive robot was we put two motors to control the steering, and we had a kicking mechanism that was basically just a large wall that spanned the maximum dimensions that we were allowed to for the defensive robot, and then it just had a motor behind it that pushed it forward and back when it saw the ball. That's the thing. And as you can see, it's not a very strong design for the kicking mechanism. It wasn't very sturdy, it fell off a few times, and it didn't have much power at all. So we scrapped that item. And we came up with this guy. This one only had one motor for the drive. Since we were only going forward and back, we didn't need anything to turn it. So we just put the one motor in to control it moving, and this allowed me to put two motors for the kicking mechanism, which was sort of like a pinball machine, flippers, and basically when the ball came close, it would see this and just flip them out, hit it farther, and it had much better results. It hit the ball much better, much farther. It could kick the ball throughout the entire field. And it was a very simplistic design still. There wasn't much that could go wrong with it, and it was much more sturdy.
That takes us to the offensive robot on the other side of the others one designing that. And that actually turned out to be a lot different from the defensive robot, both in the programming and in the hardware. For research in the beginning of the project, we had to research strategies, you know, like examples of other robot soccer designs. And we came up with the idea that the attacker has to have certain characteristics. It has to be fast to get to the ball, it has to be agile so it keeps the ball, and needs to have real kicking power and accuracy since it's going to be the one shooting at the foot. So this is a computerized version of the final attacking robot made on MLCAD. There are, obviously on the motors, there will be wheels, but with wheels on in this program, didn't look too good, so I just left them out. Also, on the back, there are two legs to help keep it stable. And that those also had smaller wheels on it to keep it in line, because it felt off and how it kind of swerved out of the way of texture to look straight. And right under the brick is the kicking mechanism. So the basic layout of the thing was as the defensive robot originally started out was the trait box design, which we decided that would be the best choice for speed and agility. And two rear legs that I said before were for stability, and the kicking mechanism was placed right under the block, so it would be easy aiming. The kicking mechanism specifically was a rotating arm design. But, originally, it was placed in this orientation where the wheel or the arm was faced downward and would kick, would rotate upwards, so it would kick the ball outward. But eventually, we figured out that if it rotated from the top and rotated down onto the ball, it would act, the pressure that it created would actually shoot the ball out straight and farther than just kicking it. So that actually, we actually found that out by accident, but they really helped us out. So that actually, it shot towards the goal, pretty far shot, and very good at its own.
Alright, so the offensive algorithm, the main principle behind the original offensive code was that the code would command the robot to find a good spot that was both aligning with the ball and the second robot. And then the robot would try to align with the spot first, and then go toward the block of the spot. Then it would align with the ball and finally pick the ball. So what could go wrong? Why did we choose it? Well, it was, no. So the problem lies within the tuning step, because very often the tolerances for the angles and for the distances of the robot conflict each other. So we just scrapped the original code. And then we came up with this. It had only three states. The first one is aligned with the ball. The second one is go toward the ball. And the final one is to keep the ball. So first of all, the robot would keep aligned with the ball until the angle difference between the angle of the robot and the angle of the ball is small enough. And if the distance from the robot to the ball was too far, then it would just stay one, which was go toward the ball. And once it was in state one, which is go toward the ball, if the light reading from the light sensor was large enough, then it will kick the ball. And you can see that we just completed a full loop here.
So for the defensive algorithm, it was simpler and less complicated compared to the offensive robot. It had seven different states. It also had four different numeric constants. And the three main variables we had was the DY, which was the distance of the ball in the upper half of the goal area, DYL, which was the distance of the lower area of the goal, and DY, which was like the distance of the ball in the lower area. And this was the first two cases under the states, which was state 0 and state 1. In state 0 and 1, we had the ball, if the ball was in the upper half of the goal area, then for state 0, it would detect if the ball was in the upper half, and for state 1, if the ball was in the upper half of the goal area and it was close to the robot, then it would activate the kicking mechanism with it. For state 2 and 3, it was if the ball was in the lower half of the goal area, then for state 2, it would detect if the ball was in the lower area and it would align to it. And for state 3, it would, while it was in the lower area and the ball was close to it, it would actually activate the kicking mechanism and shoot the ball away from the goal area. Now, the purpose for state 4 and 5 was to make sure the robot did not cross the goal area, which is right here and here. That way it wouldn't leave the goal unattended. So for state 4, we made sure that if the ball crossed this area over here, then the robot would stop at this line. right here, and for stage five, if the ball crossed around down here, then the robot would stop right down here. They would not make sure the ball was in the zone. For stage six, which was simple, it was if the ball was in between the goal areas, then the robot would just stop there, and if it was close to it, then it would just have to be a kick. That was it.
So we have a video that we would like to show show you guys. So you can see that on the left, there were our robots. The defensive robot just moved back and forth. And you can see that the way that we coded the offensive robot was kind of trade-off, because imagine that if the direction of the ball and the robot was toward the opponent's goal, and the robot was actually behind the ball, then you're going to have a good chance to shoot to the opponent's goal. Otherwise, you're going to have a good chance to score an own goal. So you got the idea. So, in the final words, we would like to thank you, Robert and Professor Paul, for helping us in this project. Without you guys, we definitely not gonna finish this project. And thank you to all of you. So, any questions?